It's a big pleasure for me to be today here presenting my work. I will be presenting some measures to try to quantify the structure of the brain. We'll start with a very brief introduction. So, as you all know, mapping and characterizing the structural brain network might help to understand how the brain works. And in the literature, we can find many different measures. For instance, we can study integration and segregation with measures like the path length, the characteristic path length, the global efficiency, the clustering coefficient, the transitivity, the modularity, and so on. However, still nowadays, compare networks and study the evolution is still a big challenge. And in this work, what we try to do is by using information, the mutual information measure, we try to quantify the structure. How structured is this brain? But perhaps I should start explaining what we mean when we say a structure. So I guess most of you will agree when I say that the brain network is not just a collection of random connections. So there's definitely an organization in this network, and there's definitely a structure, and this is what we try to measure. I will go very briefly through the main formulas of information theory, the main measures, because this is the base of my work. So it's very important to remind what these measures are calculating. So the entropy, I guess most of you are already familiar with these measures. So it's just the uncertainty of a random variable X that has a probability distribution. Then we have also the joint entropy, which is the uncertainty of a pair of random variables, X and Y. We have the conditional entropy, which is the uncertainty of a variable of a random variable Y given a random variable X. And also, finally, the mutual information, which is the measure that we've been using in this work, which measures the shared information between two random variables. To have a more visual idea of what these measures are calculating, if we have the entropy of one random variable and we have the entropy of another random variable, where there is this overlap of information, this is the mutual information. On the other hand, another thing that we've been using is the idea of a Markov chain. And a Markov chain is a stochastic process which can be described as by a transition probability. And in this transition, the probability only depends on the current state and not on the other ones. I will now explain the method by using all of these basic. So we have a brain. We have segmented this brain in a larger scale, and from each region we have a node. Obviously, these nodes are connected either by using, we can calculate these connections by using DTI or fMRI. And let's imagine we have a particle. This particle starts in a random path in one of these regions in the connectome. And this particle visits, according to the probability of the connections, visits one node after node, as you can see in the image, is randomly moving through this graph. From this concept, we have generated our model. So we can see that we have the connectivity matrix, in this case, are symmetric. And in this matrix, we mainly have the number of connections that there's from node to node. If we divide the number of connections of each node by the total number of connections, we have the probability of the node. And if we divide the amount of connections between two nodes by the probability of the node, we have the conditional probability. By using all of these, this theoretic framework, you can now see that we have probabilities of nodes, we have conditional probabilities, which means that we can directly apply the mutual information to this matrix. And this is how we understand how we apply this mutual information. For us, the mutual information calculates the information that we gain when we know which was the previous node. For instance, we will have high values if there is a high correlation between nodes, which means that from one node, I can predict also which can be the connections of the following node. and we will have very low values when this correlation is very low. For instance, in a random graph, it's very difficult to see which ones or how the nodes correlate to each other because the connections are random, so there is no, it's very difficult to predict. So, and the idea here is that the information, the mutual information will be the uncertainty of the state when we have no knowledge, minus the uncertainty when the path is known. So this is the global measure. This measure will give a single value for each network. And from this measure, we have also used the two decompositions. And in this case, each decomposition will give us a single value for each node. We have the mutual surprise. The mutual surprise is measure, this is not new. I haven't invented this name. But it mainly shows how surprising are the connections of that node. And it will have high values when the connections are very surprising, is something that we don't really expect, and will have very low values when the connection is connected to the more likely nodes. And on the other hand, we have the mutual predictability. In this case, we'll have high values when the connections of this node reduce the uncertainty of the network. And we'll have low values when the connections of this node increase the uncertainty of the network. And also, if we do the weighted sum of these two local measures, at the end we get the mutual information, which is the global measure that we've been using as well. Now we show some results. First, we tested our measures with the synthetic networks. We use the brain connectivity toolbox. This is a great toolbox for MATLAB. It's very simple to use. And we decided to generate four different types of networks. So first is just random networks. And then the last three are lattice, ring lattice, and a small wall. These last three networks, they all have characteristics and properties that we can find also in brain networks. We generated different data sets with different nodes. For instance, we generated 128 networks with 128 nodes and 156 nodes, and increasing the number of edges. And also, we generate another data set, preserving the density, because the density plays an important role in these measures. So we have a data set with 0.2 density and also with 0.2. And in this data set, what we do is we increase the number of nodes and the number of edges in order to preserve the density. These are the results with the synthetic networks. As you can see, when we have a low number of edges, there is a clear distinction, especially when we have 256 nodes. When the random networks, they have a clear lower lower mutual information. And the other three networks, which they have a bit more structure, they have a larger value. And obviously, if we keep increasing the number of edges, because the density of the graph and the network, it increases, at the end, all the graphs, they tend to have the same value, because the network, it kind of lose the properties. So at some point, if we keep adding edges and edges in a small wall network, at the end we'll have a random network because there's no small wall anymore. And if we present the density, in this case we can see that either for 0.2 or for 0.4, the measures, they tend to have quite similar values. And the next results I will show, in this case we use human networks. We have a data set with the structural networks. This information comes from the TTI. There were the matrices that were published in a quite well-known paper. It contains 10 subjects, and these 10 subjects, we have the networks at different number of partitions. And then we have also another data set we took from the Human Connecto project. This is a massive data set. It's really nice. They give it for free, the connections. And also already the connectivity matrices. And in this case, we have 461 subjects and also, again, different partitions. And what I want to say here is that I didn't generate any DTI, I didn't generate any fMRI, I just took directly the networks that were provided in, to avoid errors. In the case of the structural data set, we can see that the networks are very robust. This is, was a property that we were looking for, because what we don't want is that if we receive a new network, we suddenly have a completely different value of mutual information, because then it would be not useful. So we can see that for different numbers of partitions, we, the values are quite stable. But it's not the, the mutual information, as we increase the number of regions, it also increases the number of mutual information, which means that we have to be really careful when we compare networks with different number of partitions. And then by using the functional data set, what we could see is that the mutual information is always very similar, and that's because the density in these networks is also very, very similar. And these are the two effects that we could see with also with the synthetic data set. And now some examples of the extremes cases that we can find in the structural data set. So in the first image, we can see all the connections. And to visualize this network, I had to reduce, I had to apply a threshold because there were too many connections and it was impossible to see the network. And for the mutual surprise, the thalamus proper is the region that it gave us a lower value. And in this case, it's because the connections are very balanced as well with the probability of the next node. So if the probability of going to the node is very similar to the probability in being in the next node, that's, we can say that that's not surprising. And the other extreme is when we have a very high value. In this case, it was shown in the transverse temporal. And we could see that the connections of this node were very surprising, because this node, it, either the direction you take, the probability of being in that node is very, very low. So that was kind of surprising, because it has very specific connection, this region. And the last example, these are the results with the mutual predictability. This is the second local measure. We got very low values in the putamen. That's because it's really difficult to, as you can see in this image, it's really difficult to see according to the probabilities of these connections to try to guess which is going to be the next node that this particle will visit. And on the other hand, this is a very clear example in the temporal pole. We can see that there is a very, very strong connection to a specific node, which is different from the other ones. So in this case, we can say that we have a very high capacity of prediction, because it's very clear which is going to be, or which is the node that will have more probability in this path, which means that there is also very low uncertainty. And just now to conclude my work, we have seen, and I have shown proof of concept that the mutual information can be used to quantify the structure of different model networks. We can see that I have interpreted the connectivity graphs as a stochastic process where particles are modeled as if it were doing a random walk. The local measures can characterize new properties of the network nodes that it hasn't been shown before. And obviously, we need now a good clinical study. So the data that we've got is not enough to draw very strong conclusions, but we have seen very good performance, and we have a feeling that these measures can be used to distinguish perhaps networks with a disease or networks from healthy subjects. Yes, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions.
If you have a different resolution of the network, you also have a different degree for each individual node, and also you have a different degree within the network, so some hub nodes and normal nodes. To what extent does that influence your measure?
So yeah, the measure is influenced by the density of the network in general. I'm not sure how influence is of the degree, for instance, but yeah. We have to be really careful when comparing these networks. So we always have to take into account the density. So as I have shown, if we want to compare different subjects, we really have to be careful in generating these networks with the same density. So obviously we want to do a good study and see if these measures can be useful. It has to be have to be generated in the same way and it's following the same protocols and having the same partition, probably the same nodes and these sort of things. So yeah, it's not that easy that suddenly we are proposing a measure that can be used for any kind of networks and for any kind of any number of partitions.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.